transition really?
Yeah,
transition. Okay, so just some general housekeeping. No food and flavored drinks in the lecture theater. Yeah, so don't eat your food here. And the Wi-Fi SSID is Ninja, and the password is password. Okay? And just in case you all didn't come for the previous lesson, my name is Hui Ren. You can contact me on Twitter at Wu Hui Ren or through my email hello@wuhuiren.me. So I'm an open source advocate, and I'm also a student of Ngee Ann Poly, right? Then we have a few helpers today. So so we have Chen Tek, who is down here trying to do the audio stuff, and we have Ivan, which is over there. We have Jun Hao, who is coming later, and we have Justin Lee, who is the co-founder of Hackerspace and the ex-IBM staff. Yeah, he has more than 10 years of experience in programming. So these are some of the helpers you can look for when you raise your hand, right? So just let's do a very quick recap. So we covered on the document declaration, the web, how open standards work in general, and the web itself, and some CSS, how CSS selectors work at all. So let's have a very fun quiz right now, right? And let's play Kahoot, right? So if you visit kahoot.it, go to kahoot.it and we'll show a code right now. Yeah. So top three will get a free Microsoft T-shirt, I guess. Yeah. So if you get the top three, you'll get a T-shirt from Microsoft. Yay! Right. So very quick recap. So ready to join. Blah blah blah. Start. Come on. Okay. So this is a game code. If you visit kahoot.it, enter this game pin. Do you see this? Enter this game pin, okay? Everybody okay? So, kahoot.it, right? Okay, so we got one player in. So we got 15 players so far. So you all remember your HTML and CSS stuff, right? Yes, no, maybe? Awkward silence. Okay. Password. Too many people connected already. Sorry. I don't know, maybe. Most likely. Just now you have internet, right? It has no reason to lose internet just like that.
No, it's like everyone just connect, after connect, connect. No.
Okay, so we just restarted a router, I guess. And we'll wait a while. Oh, there's so much waiting. Rush to wait. Okay. Everything is wrong. It rains when you should.
It rains when
you should. It's on already. It's on already. Just, you have to wait.
Yeah, sorry, we just restarted the router. Yeah, we face some internet issue.
Is it pronounced as router or router? Or putter or... It refuses to start up here. It's not starting now. I don't know why. But they're not starting now. No, it's starting already. Oh, this thing problems. This thing. have you heard of Murphy's Law before? Anyone heard of Murphy's Law? No one? Anyone? Okay, so just an interesting fact about Murphy's Law is Murphy's Law is when one thing starts to go wrong, everything will start to go wrong. So in this case right now, we are kind of experiencing what we call the Murphy's Law. So in data centers, when Murphy's Law occurs, right, so it starts off with like maybe just a disk error or something, and then the entire server dies out, and then the entire rack dies out, and the entire data center dies out. That's what happens in a very large case scenario of Murphy's Law. Alright, so this thing is just not starting up really.
Is it on or off?
It's very problematic. So, everyone got into internet yet? Internet. Yes, 老板. Can I help you, 老板? It's Ninja 2.4. Yeah, I know. It's very hard.
Internet.
It's still for how long is this thing? Wait, prepare? Does it have internet yet?
Need to log in.
Huh?
Need to log in.
Yeah, the password is.
Oh, I need to see the
internet. Are you.
How do you get Netgear?
That's why I don't use Netgear again. That's why I don't use Netgear anymore. But it doesn't connect out, it just doesn't connect out. It just doesn't connect out.
When will it be a full
It's supposed to NAT out. Huh? Still not inside that. Okay. Is it seems more connected, but that's it. Set the DNS with 8.8.8. Not your DNS, but the Netgear DNS.
Mm-hmm.
I think you set your Netgear DNS.
No, 8.8.8 cannot be.
Okay, has everyone connected to Kahoot yet? Everyone has connected to Kahoot? Raise your hand if you are not connected to Kahoot yet. Sorry? It's loading. Okay. Ten ready, yeah. Oh, ZSH, right? Everyone got enter your game pin already?
The pin got problem.
Huh? What thing got problem?
The pin.
What's wrong with the 6338 9. Okay, so everyone got in? Okay, let's just wait a while more. Okay, so let's begin the quiz. Yay! Okay, so there will be 11 questions flash on the screen. You just have to pick the correct. Okay, so this is the first question. It's important for developers to compete, collaborate, make as much money as possible, develop complex projects. So a very basic question. Okay, 13 of you got it correct. So let's see who is currently top. So Alex is currently top in the list. Next question. Before internet, USA had a project named Intranet, Wide Area Network, ARPANET, BGP. Okay, so let's see. Okay, not bad. 10 people got it right. So the ARPANET was one of the projects that the US had before the internet came about. So ARPANET is a type of intranet by itself, but the project name is not intranet, right? So it's the project name is ARPANET. So which of the following is not about the World Wide Web is not true? It can run IPv6, it's supposed to be fast, it's open and accessible, it is based on open standards set by IEEE. So which one is not true, right? Oh, the questions are very fast. Okay, so number 5 is not true. The open standards is set by this Internet Engineering Task Force, which is IETF and not IEEE. IEEE is that, yeah. So it's a different organization as a whole. So you have IETF, who is the one who sets the open standards for the internet itself. Right, so let's see who got it. Okay, Alex is still top currently. So question number 4, what does HTML stands for? hypertextual many languages, hypertextual markup language, high-text markup language, hypertext markup language. Very simple question, right? Okay, so most of you got it right. So Eric is currently first. So why is HTML not a programming language? Alright, so it is a markup language, it's a declarative language, it's not Turing complete, it's loosely typed. So you got four questions here. Four answers, sorry. So the answer is it's not Turing complete, which one of you... Okay, so the question is why is it not a programming language? And not what type of language HTML is. So it's why it's not a type of why it's not a programming language. So it's not Turing complete. So Alan Turing, who came up with a term called the Turing machine with the Turing complete thing. So if any language is not Turing complete, it is not a programming language. So what is Turing complete? Turing complete is when you have a Turing machine on an infinite strip of film. It's supposed to be able to read and write zeros and ones, which are binaries, on these infinite streams of film itself. So if the Turing machine is able to do that, it is Turing complete itself. Right, so okay. So Mark is currently leading. What should be the first line of a HTML5 document? This should be simple. Exclamation mark, doc type HTML, HTML header. Okay, so most of you got it right. So this is the first line to declare the document type of a HTML document, which is to declare that it's a HTML5 document, right? Okay, so Mark is still leading. So question number 7, which of the following element text does not need a closing? Right, so HTML, HR, BR, div. So we've got two answers here, and most of you got it right as well. So HR and BR both does not need a closing tag, and it's a self-closing tag by itself, right? So you have different kind of tags that some of them, most of them need to be closed, while there are some that are in special cases such as HR and BR that does not require a closing tag and is self-closing, right? So Mark is still leading. Alright, so just remember that the top three will get a t-shirt from us later on. Right, so question number 8, what are HTML attributes, right? An element modifier, an element descriptor, an element grouping, decorators of elements. Okay, so number 1 is an element modifier. Okay, so a HTML attribute is supposed to be able to modify the particular element based on this particular attribute. So an attribute once declared within the element itself will modify the HTML element, right? Okay, so wow, 5 players just hit answer strict 3. What attribute can be used to style elements in groups? Style ID class CSS. So so half, I think like a little below the majority chose the correct answer. So it's class. So the keyword here is grouping. So you need to use this thing, this attribute attribute name class in order to set the particular group the element is in, right? So that it has whatever CSS things it needs, right? Which is declared inside a CSS class. Okay. So the attribute is not CSS. Although the language is CSS, the attribute itself is class, right? Within HTML. Okay. So final question, right? Final question. How can a div? No, it's not a final question yet. So 10th question. Start to become position on the right. Text align right, padding left 0, float right, padding right 0. Right, so the answer is obviously float right. So Okay, so it's not tax aligned right, because tax aligned right only aligns the tax and not the divider blocks, right? So a block, in order to be aligned on the right, it needs to be floated to the right. You can also use things like such as flex boxes, which we won't be covering, but you can look into flex box later on. So you use float right in order to position a block to the right, just like a div, right? So final question. Okay, we have Hello and Alanu Hihi currently in the top three. Okay, what should be done to select a certain element with ID? A postfix hash sign, a prefix hash sign, no prefix at all, or postfix required, a postfix dot sign. Okay, so it's a prefix hash sign. Wow. Okay, majority of you got it right. So prefix hash sign is when the hash is in front of everything. Right, the postfix one is when the hash is behind. Right, then you have dot, a prefix dot sign, which will be used for classes. And when there's no prefix or no postfix, it will be just a normal element by itself. So it could be HTML and all. So right, so let's look at who are our winners. Drum rolls, da 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 da. Okay, well. So we've got Hello. Hello, who is Hello? Okay, so Hello, Hello. And no? Okay, hi. And Shishi. Okay, haha. So three of you, you get the Microsoft T-shirt later on. We'll pass it to you later on. but a lot of you did quite well, I guess, because it's quite well. Yeah, so yeah, that's basically just a recap of everything we've learned last week. Anyone of you here are here for the first time? Raise of hand. Here for the first time. Okay. Surprisingly, Hello did very well, although it was her first time. Okay, so let me go through a recap of what we did last week, just to help those who didn't come for last, who weren't able to make it last week. So last week we went through things like HTML. So we have this document which you can follow through from is. What is the tiny URL for this? Okay, so there's a never mind, I'll just create a then you all just copy and paste this thing in. Are you kidding me? Okay, so this is the link, I guess. Can you all see? No, you can't. Right. Can I enlarge this? Oh, good. I can't enlarge this. This piece of crap. Okay, anyway, I'll just post it here. Can you all see the link? Lol. Can you all see the big thing? So for those who didn't come last week, you all can follow this document. This is where we left off from. We've created directories. We use this thing called Code Anywhere, which is something like Cloud9, but not as good as Cloud9. CodeAnywhere.com, you can register an account there, and do remember to register a GitHub account as well. So when you launch a CodeAnywhere.com account, right, you have to spin up an instance of PHP. Okay, do you want me to go through everything again? I mean the setting up process? No help needed to set up the CodeAnywhere. Everyone set up the CodeAnywhere already? I think silence means consent, right? Okay, Okay, I'm just gonna assume that y'all are currently here at codeanywhere.com already and have set up an instance for the PHP. Everyone done that? Okay, so once you set up a PHP instance on codeanywhere, you'll be good to go. You just have to copy and paste everything from this particular document here. No worries, all the workshops will be recorded and uploaded onto engineers.sg, and you all can play through the video again if you all missed out last week's one or this week's one, or you all gonna miss out the upcoming week one. So you can always go to engineers.sg to follow up on the workshop. Okay. Okay. So, let me just try to change the tab size, font size. Okay, I'm gonna increase the font size a little bit to, let's say, 26, I guess. Is that good? Can you all see the code? All of you can see the code, right? Is it big enough on the screen? If you can't see, right, I suggest you to move forward because there's plenty of spaces in front. I see a lot of empty seats in front. Try to talk to people. Yeah. People know how to talk, so try to talk to them or sit beside someone, so that you can help each other out, do some, probably some pair programming as well, right? So, yeah, make sure there's someone beside you, okay? So, just a recap on how we're gonna, how do you see the configuration of the instance itself, right? You right click this thing over here, and you click this thing called info. Once you click onto info, you'll open up this thing, the John Cena container, and you, when you scroll down, you see this URL over here. When you click on this URL, it'll open up this website over here, which will load your code. So it's something like that, except I don't think I have internet. Oh, I do have internet. Okay. So everyone should be on like something like that, I guess, right? You should have a page, something which looks something like that, with your header down here saying My Commerce, welcome to My Commerce, we sell various items at this store, and whatever you sell here with Taylor Swift's cat. Okay, so this, in case you didn't know, this is Olivia Benson, which is one of Taylor Swift's cats, right? Okay, I think it's a curly cat. This thing is getting on my nerves. Okay, so we have done a quick recap, and we're gonna go through some of the aesthetics part of in CSS itself. So we've done our website. It's black and white. It still doesn't look good enough. We gotta improve on top of our aesthetics. We've gone through a little bit about fonts last week, but not good enough. So we're gonna go through a little more in the in-depth side of fonts and colors and all. Right, so you have what we call the Google Material Colors. This is a color plate by Google, and it's called Material, right? This design thing is called Material, just Material. If there's a URL here which you can go to visit Google Material Colors. Okay, everyone good? And we've also got what we call Google Fonts, which is a collection of fonts available online, right? So if you go to this website, you'll be able to see lots and lots and lots of fonts available for you to download and include in your CSS file itself. So right now we're gonna incorporate these two things, right? Google Colors and Google Fonts into the website to make it look a bit nicer, right? So not nice enough, so we gotta improve it, right? So right now we're gonna modify our style.css to import Open Sans and Roboto into our website, right? So modify your style.css file and include this thing on top. Import space. It's not a new line, it's just a space. Just that there's no space here. And it's gonna be like that. Importing both Open Sans and Roboto. Followed by the body. We're gonna make the background color become white with a color of 21212121, right? So this is a dark gray. And we're gonna set the font family to Open Sans and fallback to Sans Serif if there's no Open Sans. If the Open Sans can't be loaded. So initially when the document loads, and if it fails to load Open Sans font, it'll fall back to Sans Serif, right? Which is a font that is widely available in most computers nowadays. Then we have H1, H2, H3, H4. We're gonna set this font family to Roboto and fall back to Sans Serif if Roboto doesn't get loaded. Okay, so this is a very simple thing. We're gonna modify our style.css file to incorporate these fonts and new color schemes from Google Colors and Google Fonts. Alright. So I'm gonna quickly just copy this bunch of code here, and I'm gonna copy it over. Copy it over to my style.css over here. So I've got my style.css and I got my body here with all this stuff, right? So I'm just gonna change this part and type in this. Can everyone see the code? And remember to save your file, and remember that all files are case sensitive. And oh, that's nice shirt. Okay. So everyone can see the fonts, right? I mean, the whatever is typed on the code anywhere. Yeah, I'm gonna move around as well, just in case any of y'all need help. Remember to raise your hand if you need any help. Yeah, okay. Just what is it?
Thank you. 时候是一回事。
I'm so done with this crap with him. Okay, I think some of you have some issues with the hood and UN thing. So, what do you do, right, when this thing really gets on everyone's nose? Okay, so you just right click this container here. This container thing, which is like that, yeah. Right click, destroy it, and recreate everything. Okay, so I usually use Cloud9, and it's better than this, right? This is really annoying, right? But you can't complain because it's free, right? So no complaints. So we just create everything. We have the code and everything. So no worries. Again, search for a stack PHP. Look for this thing called the PHP CentOS 6.5. CentOS 6.5. Okay, just is below the Ubuntu 14. So you can see this thing, CentOS 6.5, PHP with Apache, MySQL, PHP Miami Composer, etc. So click onto that one, then type in whatever you want name it, right? And then recreate. Okay, this should fix the problem, I hope, right? So that's what you do when that thing annoys you, right? You recreate everything. Yes, you recreate everything. So it's gonna take some time to deploy a container. If any of you all have not deployed before, y'all just do what I just did, so y'all should be fine afterwards, right? Deploying. If any one of you having issues, right, raise up your hand and we'll be there.
The food is somewhat really come easy, but we will set up one. So if they got problems, if they got internet problems, then we just ask them eat first.
Okay. So we are currently setting up the food. The food is here, but we are still setting it up. So we'll let you. Okay, just raise up your hand if you have any issues. Okay. So now I'm going to go through the entire process of doing up the files and all. Right, so just follow through if you have not done it before. So right here we have the container. So this thing here with the triple, with three bars over here, which looks like a barcode, is what we call a container. Okay, so right click. Okay, so right click this thing and create file index.html. Okay, it's case sensitive. So everything in lowercase index.html, right? So create a file. Then we go to this this thing that we previously had and we copy it. Right. And then paste it all in. Then save. Control S to save. Right. Afterwards we're gonna create a new file. A new folder, sorry. Name assets. Lowercase as well. Assets in lowercase. New folder, assets. And inside assets, right, we're gonna right click create new folder CSS. Okay. This thing just crapped out on me. Okay, so finally it's not even creating my folder. Okay, so now that we have this folder called CSS, we're going to right click and we're going to create a new file named style.css. Style.css in lowercase, okay? So go back to this ninja coding thing here. Scroll down and you see this thing here. Copy everything. Right. Just copy this and then paste it in. Okay? And then remember to modify your file. Okay, I just modify it now. Let me just modify the entire document for you. So, we're gonna import in the fonts. Are you kidding me? Okay, so Ctrl A, Ctrl X. Yay, okay, so yeah, just modify this file. And then import the fonts and everything. Everyone all good? All got to index.html, created your style.css. Yeah? Okay, so after you have done the importing and then you have created your you have done your fonts and everything, go to this here and refresh. You should get something that looks slightly better with better looking fonts and a better looking background color with a better looking color for your font, right? So you can see that the gigantic fonts here are using Roboto while the rest are using Open Sans font. This is because of what we have declared here. For the body font, which are your typical font fonts, we've declared a font type as we've imported Open Sans and Roboto, but we are using Roboto for the big H1, H2, H3, H4. And as for the font family, we are gonna use Open Sans and with a Sans with a fallback to Sans Serif. Right. So everyone, correct if you all have raise out your hand if you all have any problems. Okay, so I've noticed I just written really bad code. I'll change it. Look at that evil laugh from Justin. He's laughing at my incompetency. Okay, so I was missing the HTML tag, which is something that is quite important. Actually, it's one of the most basic important thing, which I didn't include. So I'm gonna add that back in. Okay, so now your HTML is a valid document after adding in the HTML tag. So everyone okay? Sorry? Okay, so did you get the URL just now? Okay, so the URL is this is the URL. All right. That's the URL for those who need the document, the one. Yeah. Okay, and then you can launch your codes and everything. Okay, so now that we've imported the fonts and everything, and colors and everything, right? So we're gonna move on a little bit to the next step. Let's bring our website. It looks slightly better now with normal looking fonts, better looking fonts actually. Yeah. So let me introduce to you what we call the postfix pseudo classes. So remember the prefix things and so we also got what we call postfix, right? So prefix is before and postfix is after, right? So most big pseudo classes, right, are things that are applied after a particular selector that is imaginary, right? It's pseudo, right? Pseudo means, sort of like imaginary, something like non-existent, right? But it's dead, right? It's dead. So let me go through what is postfix pseudo classes, right? So if you see carefully, then you have this colon over here. Do you see this colon here? The A is postfix with a colon, hover. And you also got this thing, the after pseudo class, right? So both of these are pseudo classes that don't exist. So what happened when I add this code in, right? So let's take a look at, do I have anything that can show a URL or something? So let me just quickly add some to modify the exotic tab a bit, right? Give me a second. So I added a href anchor link to this text over here, exotic short hair cat. So you'll see that it is, when I add the anchor link, that is blue and highlight underlined, and when I click right, there's actually a URL, it'll lead me somewhere else. Right. So it'll lead me to products.html, which is not existent currently. So I added an anchor link here. You all can add it in as well. Over here, add an anchor link. Okay, so let me demonstrate to you the effect of pseudo classes. Okay, so let's add a hull effect. Right, so when I refresh, I should get the same thing, right? But when I hover over, do you see the color change? Okay, so when I hover over, the there's this imaginary post hover thing that will be inside this particular element, right? So when I have the pseudo class of a hover, it will be applied to the particular pseudo class. Okay? I mean, yeah. Postfix pseudo class, right? So you can see that it has been applied here. Alright. So previously some of us had some issues with like text below the two blocks, right? So let's take a look at the two blocks as we have. So we've got the left block, right block, and then what if I add a paragraph here and say, let's say lmao, right? Lmao. I have a paragraph here and say lmao. And then what you notice is that the lmao is a bit lmao-ish. Okay, so let me import the image first. Let me plagiarize an image first. So I really like this cat octopus, and it looks very cute, I guess. So I'm just gonna save the image and upload it. So under access folder, I'm gonna create a new folder called img, which stands for image, and I'm gonna upload Olivia Benson. Click here, click upload, and it'll open up here. I'll drag it Oliver Benson in, and Oliver Benson will get uploaded. Alright, and I'm gonna rename this to Oliver Benson. Okay, so wrong tab. So right now you see that the lmao, right, it's down here. It's supposed to be below it, right, by right, because it's outside of the block, it's outside of both of the blocks, It's supposed to be down here, but right now it's appearing here. Why? Right, that's a clear issue we have. Right, so it's clearly outside of this block manager, right? So we need to apply a sudo after class to this block manager itself to fix this problem. Okay, so let me show you very quickly. No, I'm not going to edit the style. And I'm going to edit this. I'm going to remove this clear both here. And have the clear both inside the after class. And this, what will happen next is that you see that some magical thing will happen, right? So let me open up a copy of this, so in case you can make a before and after effect comparison, right? Are you kidding me? Okay, so now you see that the lemao is below, which is what we wanted all along, right? Do you see the before and after effect? So let me show you. Do you see it? Pretty obvious, right? So yeah, as Captain Obvious says, right? So this is an after class, which is something that this is a pseudo class. It doesn't exist, right? It doesn't really exist, how can I explain it? It just doesn't exist, right? Okay, so it's this after, right, is something that is after the element that does not exist. Alright, so imagine that there's an element after it, but there isn't any element actually. Yeah. So what this means is that, right, you wouldn't need to create an additional element and append the class to it. You can just use this after pseudo class to append the content blank clear both and display table, so that it'll clear both sides and make it onto a new block itself, and it won't float up to the left side, right? Because previously we have a float, which would make things float up. Right? We want it to be the elements behind not to float up, right? We don't want the other elements to be affected, so we apply this after pseudo class. Okay, so back to the code again. So we have learned two basic pseudo classes, the hover and the after class. Everyone clear? Good. All good. Fantastic. The pizza? Okay, so lunch is ready. So we'll be heading down to you can leave your belongings behind. There's people that will be here to guard, and as people always say, Singapore is a safe country, I think. But if in case things goes missing, I'm just kidding. So lunch is here. You can go outside to the piano area.
I'll lock this place where everyone
leaves. Sorry?
I'll lock this place where everyone
leaves. Okay, so Wei Liang will lock this place up when everyone leaves. Okay, so feel free to grab your lunch. It's at the piano area. Yeah, it's lunch time now. Lunch will be until 1 o'clock, 1 p.m. So be back here by 1 p.m. and we'll start off to the second part of the CSS itself, right? Thank you. Sorry?
The slides in your Jar coding class, do you have a link to those slides where you have command lines?
Command lines? Or
I mean, the slides that you were showing.
This slide? Yeah. I'll put up the link. No worries. go have your lunch first. Go get lunch. Right.
I'm going to be gone.
Can lah.
That's all the problem.
The reason why was because
no need to transition eh.
Yeah, I did press. Okay, sorry, continue.
Okay. So, I hope you all had a good lunch. Did you all had there was enough food today, so very good. You all had a very good lunch, right? Tasted like pizza. Oh, yeah. So, when you actually go for meetups, and most meetups, they have sort of like pizzas as well. So, if you go to meetups often, you get sick of eating pizza, actually. Yeah, so... Yeah. Okay, so for those who are still having issues with codeanywhere.com, please recreate your container and copy the code from the document online. Okay? Delete your container and then recreate if you have issues with the codeanywhere.com. Okay? it's not controlled by us, so that's the easiest way of fixing things, right? Right. So I've updated the document as well. So if you need to copy and paste your code, right, you can go ahead and go to the same document again, go to this Google Docs, and then copy and paste the class and index.html stuff. Right. Okay, so while I go through the slides, right, I will also be updating the codes on this this document. So if so you can actually copy and paste from this document. Keep this document panel open. So in case you need to copy and paste some code, right, just go ahead and copy and paste, and it can be done very easily. Yeah, everyone okay? Good. Okay, so now let's move on to the next part. So before lunch, we went through the postfix sudo classes, which are imaginary classes used to modify your elements as usual. Okay, so we have gone through some of them, and we have fixed some issues that we previously had, and make things look a lot better now, right? So, but you know, we want to make it more responsive in the sense that, you know, you have mobiles, you have tablets, you have desktops, right? So these devices, right, they vary in screen sizes, and we need, as a front-end designer ourselves, we need to be experts, and we need to design for all platforms, right? Go ahead with a responsive design that will scale the elements and change the elements as according to when the user screen size changes. Okay, so we're going to introduce to you what we call media query. So let's take a look at desktop view first. So this is what you see on desktop view, then tablet, and then mobile, right? So you see that there's sort of like a difference here, and it looks as big for mobile viewing. So even if a person was viewing on a mobile, they will be able to see your text clearly. They'll be able to see what is the images and all that. They're all scaled nicely and pretty nice. Yeah. So we want to achieve this. So we can previously we use Max Width to adjust our images to become more responsive by setting a max depth width 100% to make the images responsive. So now we're going to introduce to you what we call the media queries. So media queries are like that, right? So you have the mobile view and the tablet view. So within this stuff itself, right, you can actually put in classes into this thing. Encapsulated within these curly braces. Right, so I'm gonna quickly show you how we're gonna do this, right? I'm gonna copy and paste the code onto the Google Docs as well. So no worries, right? No worries at all. So right here you can see that we have got our div left block and our div right block, right? So our blocks are down here, left and right. But when we scale it to mobile size, right, can you really see the image? You can't really see the image when it's on mobile size. So we need to fix this issue, right? So how can we fix this, right? So we're gonna do a really simple code here. Let me just copy and then paste it onto onto the Google Doc as well. So I'll type some codes and then I'll paste it and then explain to you, right? So right now you see that our image right has become one single image big on the line, and then the next element has moved downwards. Right, do you see that happen? Okay, then when we scale up, when we scale even bigger, 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 and then it becomes like that. It hits a point where it'll just become 100% size. You see that? You see that happening? Right, so this is what we call media queries to do responsive design. I've updated the document here to include the media queries. Right at the bottom of style.css, you see the media queries down there. Feel free to copy and then paste it in your code itself. Right. So this is how you can do. So what happens is that, right, these codes here, they will overwrite the existing elements that we previously had. So the previous one, we had a width of 50%. So when it hits the mobile media query of max width 768 pixels, it will then shift the width and then transform it to 100%, as you have seen just now, right? Quite a magical thing, right? So that's how basically media queries work. They look at the size of your screen, right? And then adjust and apply the classes as accordingly. Okay, everyone has copied the code from the Google Doc as already? And got the same thing? Did you all achieve the same effect? Okay, so I noticed that some of your codes are not very, very readable. Okay, so remember, change the spaces to 4 space. You can see this thing here. There's a spaces 4 down here. Click to 4 spaces. There's no standard for this. There's no particular standard that enforces 4 spaces or 1 space or 2 spaces. But I generally use 4 spaces. Then once you click 4 spaces, go to edit and click on this thing called beautify. Okay? It will beautify your code and then make it look nicer. Right. It's not really beautifying this. So your indentations and all will be fixed by this beautify command. Actually, I should just use this. Yeah, so now my code got beautified. So it looks more beautiful. You can apply it to index.html as well. So if your, let's say your index.html, the indentations are incorrect. Let me show you what happens when the indentations are incorrect. So something like that. I just do a edit and I click beautify. All my indentations will be corrected. And my code will look nice. Right. So this is to keep our code looking great and fantastic. Like what you see here. Okay? So now your code should look more readable in some way, right? Have you all done the media queries and verified your code? All good. Okay, so let's move on. So we've achieved some responsiveness with using two media queries. But if let's say we want to do more than just that, and in the future where we have to do more than just floating left, floating right, and tons of things, we have to keep writing a lot of things, right? So no worries, we've got this amazing front-end framework called Twitter Bootstrap. although this framework is quite bulky, in the sense that it requires jQuery and lots of things, you'll still be able to do it quite well. It still runs okay, although a bit slow on very old laptops. So we're going to use Twitter Bootstrap to help bootstrap our e-commerce store and make development much faster, right? We want to do this so that we don't have to keep writing. There's really things done for us. So let's try and there's no need for reinventing the wheel for this yet. So let's go ahead and put on Twitter Bootstrap. So you can get Twitter Bootstrap from getbootstrap.com. If you visit getbootstrap.com, you'll see this thing. Bootstrap is the most popular HTML, CSS, and JS framework for developing responsive mobile-first projects on the web. Right, so the Bootstrap project was initiated by this small company in the United States called Twitter. Quite a very small company, and they have a very very small project called Bootstrap, right? So let's not go through this thing first. So let's go to getbootstrap.com. You see that we've got this site. Keep it open. Keep the getbootstrap.com open first. We're gonna do some things later on, right? So keep it open for now, right? So we're gonna go through how Bootstrap works. Bootstrap has this thing called the grid system. So we have this grid system thing. So let's go through what this grid system is even, right? So similar to floating left and floating right, but at this moment we have something easier for us, which is called the grid system, that help to make our life a lot easier, right? So how does this grid system look like? So In the HTML document itself, you have this thing called the container, HTML. The class is a container class. And within the container itself, there will be role. So you have a container. You have a role within the container, and you've got columns within the container. So container, inside, what's inside a container? A role. What's inside a role? A column. Okay, so you notice that it's called column-lg-12. Okay, we are not trying to promote the brand LG here, but LG stands for large. Alright, so there's different kind of views. There's extra small, small, medium, and large. So let's think of it in a very logical manner, right? Extra small will be extra small mobile devices. Small will be your small mobile devices. Medium will be your tablets. and some desktop, small size desktops, and you have LG, which is large, which is most of the desktops here I'm gonna run on. So you can adjust, we'll go into more details to how we can achieve like different views within the mobile itself. So we've got, and this 12 here, right, means that there's actually 12 columns within a row, right? Just keep in mind that within a row, there's 12 columns. So let me show you how it works, right? So you've got a row, and you've got 12 columns. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So just for your information, this thing took a while to make, and it was a pain in the ass. Right, so this, you can see that there's 12 columns down here. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is how it would look like. So if you have, let's say, 2, right? Column LG 2, it will be taking up 2 space. Column LG 3, it'll take up 3. LG 4, take up 4. Blah blah, etc. etc. So when you got LG 12, it takes up the entire row. Simple, understand? All of you can understand the grid system? Pretty simple, right? So finally, I want to introduce this last thing you need to know, which is called the offset. So once we get column large 4, and we also input another class called column large offset 4, you get this. Right, so in front of it, right, there will be 4 invisible columns, but they don't exist at all. So it's just an offset of 4 columns, and this column here is 4. Is it confusing? No? Good. Simple, right? So this is basically your grid system within Twitter Bootstrap itself. Container, row, columns, 12 columns, and you can offset using offset. Right. So this would be something like what you will see after you use Twitter Bootstrap, right? This is something you will achieve after you use the Twitter Bootstrap. You see that you've got some, your website will be more responsive and you sort of write lesser CSS codes, right? But this Twitter Bootstrap is not to completely replace all your CSS code writing. It's just to help you do some heavy weight lifting at the beginning so that you can focus on doing the more important things, right? So it's not a complete replacement for CSS code typing. You still have to type CSS code, just lesser. Okay, so let's get on to doing it actually. So I've already prepared some stuff on Cloud9 and I'm gonna transfer it over. So yeah. Okay. So I'm just gonna copy and paste. Right. What a genius. So you notice that I've cut short a lot of codes actually, and generally leaving behind the general styles. Generally leaving behind general styles, haha. So, you see that there's a lot of heavy lifting that is already done by Bootstrap that we don't really need to care, because Bootstrap has done it for us. So thank you, Bootstrap. All right. I've updated the code on the document itself, and you can feel free to copy it in. So let's take a look at what our website looks like now. Okay, so it looks like, come to me, Olivia Benson, _. Actually, no. So for just a very quick tip, so if you want to add a space, so-called space, in your file names, don't add space. Replace the space with a hyphen, not underscore, but a hyphen. Okay, so so in programming context, hyphen actually means a space. Yeah, and underscore means a connector, so it's like an N kind of thing. But yeah, that's the difference between a hyphen and a underscore, right? So I've named my image file Olivia - or hyphen Benson.jpg. So when I refresh my page, I'll get something like that, right? With Olivia Benson here, my commerce store home products drop down. Ta-da! So have you all copied the code already? So let's go through our code that we copied just now, right? Don't just blindly copy and paste, right? So let's start off from the top. You would have noticed that we've included this thing called latest compiled and minified CSS. This is the latest and compiled CSS from a CDN provider called MaxCDN, and they have kindly put up a public CDN for people to use. And this is the style sheet. This is the Bootstrap style sheet that we are using. You can see here, bootstrap.min.css. So what does MIN stand for? Does anyone here know? Anyone knows? Hey, no, you kid. Yes? Yes, okay, great. You've got a t-shirt already, right? You don't need one more, right? Okay, no problem. So yes, it represents minified. I think the answer was really there just now. Which means our latest compiled and minified CSS. So I'll just go through very quickly what minified does. So minifying a CSS file would mean that removing all the spaces from a CSS file and removing unnecessary things from a CSS file. And when there's compiling, it might actually change some stuff if depending on what kind of compiler you're using. So some of it might be changed to just very simple .a dot something like that. We're not gonna go. So anyway, minified means that it becomes smaller, right? That's it. That's really it. It makes the file become smaller. And why is it that we need to make files smaller, right? Let's go back to the essentials of the web. What is the essential concept of web, right? The web needs to be open and accessible, right? So in order for it to be accessible to everyone, including people in the developing countries, we don't want to eat their bandwidth, right? We want to make it fast, which is also another essential concept of the web itself. It needs to be fast. Okay? So when we make a file smaller, it's obviously gonna get downloaded faster. And other than that, it's also smaller and eats up lesser bandwidth, so that developing countries will be able to access your website and it wouldn't cost them a bomb, in simple terms, right? Yes. So by minifying your files and keeping your files as small as possible, you're actually keeping the web open and accessible to everyone, including developing countries, right? So this, on the second line, we've got this optional theme. Yeah, you can actually don't include this, but I just included it because why not, right? Okay, so crap. Okay, so there's a code that needed to be changed. Index.html, there's some part that needs to be changed over here where I included some shit. I forgot to change the name. So change this part to style.css from style-6.css into style.css. Okay? And then the font should change. Right, so now the font changed. Now we've included our style.css, our default style.css. Okay, so now this is where the changes are more obvious, right? Let me drink some water first. We've got a nav element here. Nav class equals nav bar default dash default. Right, so within Bootstrap .css itself, right, there's this class named navbar. Okay, and when we specify navbar dash default, right, it's specifying the theme for the navigation bar, right? So there's different kind of things. There's inverse, there's different colors, which you can actually explore from this segment of Bootstrap under CSS, I think. Oh, it's under components. So it's under name bar here. Components hashtag name bar. You can see that there's default name bar, there's blah blah blah. Blah 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 blah. You can look at all this code here and you know what should be done and why should it be done that way, right? It can also be inverted. So nav bar dash inverse would mean that it'll be black color, which is inverse, right? So the opposite of black is white, right? I think. Where was I? Okay, so these are some of the classes that we have. Okay, so other than just the default container, we've also got a fluid container, which will take up the whole screen. Okay, so a container by itself, right, it will have some padding and margin inside the container itself. Right, there will be some spaces. So what do I mean by space here? So there'll be some space here. Do you see some space here? Yes, there's some space here. This is the default container. And then when we use a container fluid, a fluid container, there'll be very less space here. You see there's very less space here? There's very less space here as well. There's more space in the container. Okay, so container fluid essentially means that there's lesser space. Right, there's lesser padding. Okay? So that's the difference between a container and a fluid container. Okay? And then we've got the name bar header. So this thing here, I'll show you what it looks like. So let's do this together, right? So when we make our screen smaller, you see what happened, right? You see that this thing comes out. You see this three bar here? You saw it, right? So and then you can click onto it as many times as you want. Okay, this is the responsive part of Bootstrap that's been really done for you. And this that particular part. Okay, so you can see that it's here. This button thing, you saw that the three lines thing, right? So the three lines are created from this icon bar here. So there's three lines of this, which means that there'll be three lines of bar down there. Okay, so your nav brand, which is over here. And then we've got our standard navigation links, right? So collapse, right, means that when it becomes smaller, it'll collapse into what we saw just now. Okay? Then inside here, right, we've got an unordered list, which was what we touched on the first week, unordered list. Nav bar right. So nav bar right would means that the navigation will be on the right side. Which you will see here, it's on the right side. Is it on your right? Yeah, it's on your right. Okay. Anyway, and then we've got a collection of links here. Home, products, and a drop-down. Okay, so a drop-down, inside a drop-down, you have another unordered list here, you can see. So you can put in more links in the drop-down. You see this? Yeah. Okay, so this is basically our navigation bar that we created just now. Very simple, right? Okay, so if you want to learn more about the navigation bar itself, you can visit the components site of bootstrap.com. Yeah, bootstrap.com, right? Then now comes the body part where we really want to specify our content that will be loaded. So our cats and all that. We've got div class container, div class role, so you can see that we've got a container here, and within the container, we've got a row. And within a row, we've kindly offsetted it by 4. And we've centralized it to the center. So you can see that it's actually offsetted here, right? So let's inspect element. And let's go deep down here. So you can see that we've got a row here. We've got a container here, right? Do you see the container? And inside the container, we've got a row. And inside a row, you've got an offset. You see that yellow part? The yellowish part is the offset part. The yellow thing. Yeah. It looks like yellow. And the purple part is the padding. And the blue color part is the content size, which is MD4, medium 4. Right? All good. Oh, do y'all see the container effect here? Good, right? Okay, so then we've got our standard 50-50 space here. So, what do we do this time to make it responsive? Well, initially we define it as MD6, which is 50% of 12. Because you get 12 divided by 6, you get, 12 divided by 2, you get 6. Right, we want to split it into half. So we've got it split into half. Here, you can see. And then when it becomes smaller, it will become 12. Because we specify a :SM-12. Right, so let's look at the effect again. It's similar to what we have done earlier on. Do you see this? And then when it goes to a certain point, it then pops up. It'll become 100%. It'll become 50% again. So just now it was 50% only. This is just 50%. And here, then we finally get. This is 50%. Then we get 100%, right? Which is 12. Right. All clear on this? SM small. SM 12 and 6. Okay, all good, right? And then we've got, yeah, the same thing applied to here. And finally, we want to include the jQuery library. So jQuery library is a library that is called jQuery. So it's a JavaScript library that was written quite a while ago. Quite a long time ago, actually. And it's currently at version 3. It's also it's basically a library to help you get started on the functions and all. It has some predefined functions to make things easier for your life. And it's also quite bulky, right? If you look at the size of the jQuery library itself, right, it's around, you can visit jQuery.com and then you'll see the size of jQuery. Right. Where's the size? Get it. Let's just do a network test and then we'll see how big this file is, right? So very quickly we refresh our page and then we've seen the bootstrap file is 120 kilobytes. The theme is another 22 kilobytes with 84 kilobytes and 36 kilobytes. So we've got around 240 kilobytes. Yeah, so we've actually added in 240 kilobytes. Just to make our life easier. So you can see that, right, Bootstrap actually makes our life easier, but because of how it is, right, it's a front-end framework. It has a lot of JIT. It's very huge. It's very slow. Okay, it's 240 kilobytes, which is quite huge. And so, so if necessary, try not to use jQuery. Try not to use Bootstrap unless you're doing a big project, right? Unless you are making full use of the project itself, you don't need Bootstrap, okay? Simple. But later on, right, in the week 4, we'll teach you how to minify and how to create a build process to make sure that all your files, right, will only include classes and all that is needed for whatever you need to do, right? So, but let's continue on from here. So now we've known that we've got a jQuery library, we've got a minified Bootstrap class as Bootstrap CSS as well. You can see here a minified Bootstrap CSS. Minified Bootstrap JavaScript file. Okay, so inside this JavaScript files, it will contain all the functions that is needed to run your navigation bar, your drop downs, and everything. Right? All clear? Okay, so so I assume now that you are all experts in CSS and HTML and all that, right? So everything must have been a very smooth sailing journey for you. Bootstrap and everything has been easy and piece of cake for you. So right now we're gonna do something more interesting, okay? We're gonna dive straight to PHP. Okay, so we've got some experts around here who are quite good at PHP as well. So Justin in particular is very good at PHP. He's been doing PHP for how many years?
5 months.
That's a lie. So I assume that's 5 years. Okay, so we've been doing PHP for 6 years, I guess. And yeah, so PHP is one of the PHP, right? You see that what it represents is PHP hypertext preprocessor. So PHP is PHP hypertext preprocessor. It sounds funny, right? So it's what we call a recursive acronym. Okay, all got it. It's a recursive acronym. So what is PHP? PHP hypertext preprocessor. All right, got it. Okay, never mind. Okay, so what happens when you run PHP, essentially, right? So when a user visits a website, the web server receives the request, the PHP file is found and sent to the PHP interpreter. The PHP code is then interpreted and result is sent to the web server. The web server then serves the processed PHP content. Simple? All understand this? Okay, so let's go in depth a bit more to how this even works, right? So when you visit some website, some small company website such as Facebook.com, they run PHP, right? There's plenty of small websites out there that run PHP, right? So what other small websites run PHP? I guess pretty much that's about that's one of the smallest website that runs PHP, I think. There's also other websites out there, such as Alibaba that runs on Java Spring Framework. Those are other languages, right? So, but we are looking at what PHP does here. So, when you visit a website, PHP, visit Facebook.com, the Facebook.com server, it has a web server. It could be Apache, it could be Nginx, but I think Facebook uses their own Facebook web server or something. So anyway, the web server, something like, for example, Apache, will receive the request. Oh, it's a request from blah blah, host is what, URI is what, file name is what, HTTP version is what, etc, etc. So many headers information, right? So let me give you a very quick look to how this works, right? So, when I visit Facebook.com, okay, this is very slow website. Okay, so let's close all the chat boxes. And then, inspect element. Okay. So just an interesting fact, Facebook has this front-end framework called React.js, and Justin is an expert in React. Alright. Yes, Justin? His no is a yes. So you can see that when you send a request, right, there'll be a URL. Oh, this thing is very small. You see, it's crazy. This website takes up 8 MB. Right. It takes up 8 MB just to render this entire page. And it's, yeah, it's how sad the web has become. Now it becomes 10 MB. Yeah, anyway, so when you send a request, right, to Facebook.com, when I visit this URL like that, it's a GET request. Then the file I requested was just slash. You see here? There's nothing behind. I didn't type in LL or something. So when I do, then it will be something else. Right, so let's try LL. You see, the file you see here is ll.php. Just now it was just a slash, right? Then the domain, and pretty much that's it, right? That's what really happens when you visit facebook.com, right? The web server receives the request that is. The web server receives the request, and then it sees that, oh, it's actually a slash, right? So what is the slash going to represent? So as usual, slash represents the index file, and in this case, it could be index.html or it could be index.php. So, but for Facebook.com, it would be index.php. So index.php is then sent to the PHP interpreter, or the and there will be a PHP engine running underneath. The Xen PHP engine, and then the PHP code is within index.php itself will be interpreted, right? It'll read through the entire index.php code, and then it'll run, and the result, whatever is outputted on index.php, is then sent to the web server again. So Apache then, so you give me LL, okay, now I send the LL, display a message LOL to the particular web visitor, right? So that's really it, right? So now I want you all to do a very simple hello world program in PHP, right? Actually, this is just this part here. Angular bracket question mark PHP echo hello world, right? So let's try this out now. Okay, so under here, I'm gonna try to not kill myself. Hello world.php. So I'm creating a file name hello world.php. PHP. So in order to run this PHP thing, we need to start it off like something like a document declaration in HTML, but this time we are declaring that what is here is PHP code, okay? So that PHP will know that, oh hey, we're gonna start running PHP, we're gonna start interpreting PHP code from here onwards, right? Anything before that, right, will not be interpreted as PHP. So anything here will not be interpreted by PHP, okay? So now let's just do a very quick and easy echo hello. Let's make it more exciting. Bonjour. Is this how you pronounce it? And close it with a semicolon, right? And then we're gonna visit slash hello dash world dot php. Slash hello dash world.php. After you have created a file here like that, new file hello dash world.php. Okay, save the file and hit here. Look at this. Bonjour. Right, let's go back to the code again. All good. So actually we can do more things to it. We can put like hola, I'm Taylor Swift, right? Okay, so when you change the code, right, and then you refresh, right, you'll say this: Bonjour, hola, I'm Taylor Swift, I'm a snake. Right, so In case you all didn't get the reference, you can search it up yourself. Okay? So, yeah, everyone got this? Easy, right? Okay. So now that we've done a hello world file, we've achieved a next stage of web development. We're gonna go big. We're gonna create the next Alibaba of Singapore, right? And name it Carousel, right? And then that's really about it for the first part, which is just echo hello world, right? This is a very simple function that anyone could do, and now we have achieved that thing that anyone could do. You are now anyone, right? But we want to do more than just anyone. We want to become number one, right? So, but in order to become number one, we need to go through some simple instructions that all humans should be able to understand, right? So this simple instructions is called syntax. So within every language itself, we've got this thing called syntax, which is construct of every single life, right? So in HTML, with the construct of every HTML stuff, all the structure itself, which represents what HTML really is. So in PHP, we also need structure to govern its life, right? We need structures to help us have some basic form of governance within life. So PHP needs that as well. It needs to know what you're writing. It needs to know what you're even typing. So we need to know how to write this code in a structural way. Okay, so we've got this thing called syntax. So the first thing I want you all to know is that we are going back to secondary school right now, right? We are going back to our basic fundamentals of algebra, right? So in algebra and mathematics, we've got this amazing thing called integers. Anyone know integers? Okay, so none of you know. Go back to secondary school right now, alright? Okay, so integers could be negative numbers. Zero is one of the integers. It has no decimal places, it has no decimal points or anything. It's really a number like that. It can be negative, it can be positive, or it can be neutral, which is zero. Right, this is just one of the algebra things you would have learned in secondary school. And just want to refresh your memory a bit here. Other than that, we've got booleans, which are true and false, right? There's no maybe, okay? It's just true and false. Very simple. Not like life, where there's always this maybe, right? And we've got string. This is a string, right? Just now we printed out an echo hello world and all of that. That was a string. Simple, wasn't it? Right, we've understood that there's integers, booleans, strings. What else is there, right? Floats. 3.14 something something something, which I don't really know, which is just a pi representation. So essentially floats are things with decimal points behind that could go up to 32 bit floating points, I think. I forgot how many bit floating point it is, but it's around there. So it can go up very long, but the longer it goes up to, the lesser precision you have. Right, so floats are not as accurate as integers. Okay, if you go beyond a certain limit, right, and you do calculation, it can't calculate properly because that's how those work. It you can't have a very fixed precision in some sense, right? And that's why when you do calculations that are sensitive, you need different kind of programming languages to do this kind of calculations, because some programming languages are better at doing this sort of float calculations and all that, very specific. And you've got arrays. It can be an array of numbers, it can be an array of strings, it could be a hash table, right? Anyone knows what's a hash table? Hash table? Okay, so hash table sounds like hash brown, but it's not. It's a table. Okay, so you've got this thing, you've got a representation of a key and a value, similar to what we've learned in CSS, where we've got a key and value and within encapsulated within the curly braces. So essentially what we have here is a hash table. Okay, very simple, right? So yeah, we'll go into that, into how arrays work later on, right? PHP is a very special language in terms of arrays, right? And we've got now. Now is not void. Now is now. Yeah. So it's like nothing, but it's just now, right? Sounds weird, doesn't it? Right. But now is a type of variable as well. In mathematical terms, we've always come across this term as well. All right. Then we've got also void, which is not now. Okay. Void is essentially empty and nothing. Okay. So, but by default, PHP is juggling. So in the circles, you see like, oh, there's like people who juggle things around, and that's what PHP is. It's a clown that juggles the variable types. So any variables can be integers, it can be booleans, it can be blah blah blah. So what it means that it's a loosely typed language. So different languages, some of them are strictly typed. So strictly typed languages would be something like Java, Java Hack, what else? Python, they are more strictly typed. And we've got loosely typed languages such as JavaScript, PHP, and many, pretty much about it. So these are loosely typed languages. So let's take a look at some of the examples first. So you don't need to type this code, okay? But you should if you want to. Okay. So and what we're trying to do here is we're gonna try to juggle the variables. So when you can see that we declare variables with a dollar sign in front. Okay. So let me ask you a question. When you receive a file, when the computer receives a file, how does it know if it's a variable? It doesn't, right? It can't really know if it's a variable unless there's something that tells it, oh, this is a variable. So in PHP, we tell PHP that this is a variable using a dollar sign. You see that dollar sign there? So now when PHP reads through, it knows that, hey, this is a variable. And we are setting a variable as hello world. And when we echo the same variable, this is some variable, it will output hello world. After that, we can change that same variable that we've declared early on to 5. And we echo it again, it will output 5. If you ever try to do this in strictly typed languages such as Java or anything else like Python and all, you can't do it because they are strictly typed and they don't juggle the variables around. Unlike PHP, where you can juggle the variables around and all that, right? The types can change very easily just like that, just by setting it like that. You have already changed the variable type. Very easy and loosely typed, right? So we've understood some part of the variable juggling. Let's go on to more of the complex part of the operators. So anyone know what are operators? No one? Okay, so I think you need to go back to primary school already. So this is some things that we've learned in primary school. Plus, minus, divide, etc, etc. Right, so let's go through very simple one. Addition, subtraction, modulus, multiply, division, power of, set, is equal, strict equal, add 2, subtract 1, increase by 1, decrease by 1, and or, and that's it. Right, so let's go through it more slowly this time. Right, modulus is something that would be a bit particularly new to those who have not learned programming yet. So modulus is when you divide something and you get a remainder. So let's say when you do 5 modulus 2, what is the remainder? Anyone know what's the remainder of 5 divided by 2? 1. Yes, exactly. So When you do that, right, when you 5 modulus 2, you get 1. It's essentially getting the remainder of what has been divided off. So 5 modulus 3, you get 2. 5 modulus 4, you get 1. What about 5 modulus 5? You get 0. Yes, exactly. So that's how modulus work. Right, this is a new operator that you might not have heard of. And okay, this is easy. So division is, there's no dot slash dash dot. In these languages, in PHP, we've got this front slash, which represents a division. So if 5 slash 5 is essentially equivalent to 5 divided by 5, which is 1. Right? And we've got power off, which is what is this thingy? It's Error? What?
Parrot.
Parrot.
Carrot.
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 Oh, carrot is a carrot. Wow. TIL. This thing is carrot. Okay, thank you. So, this is a carrot. Okay. Does it look like a carrot? Okay. So, yeah, this is a power off, which is which you will have learned in secondary school, I think. Yeah, you would know what is this. This is a set. So set was what we shown you just now. Dollar sign variable equals something something, right? But a single equal sign is setting something. Okay, a single equal sign is setting of the variable. But a double equal sign is checking whether the value is the same, is equal or not. And we've got a triple equal sign, which is a strict equal comparison. Right, this time, since PHP is loosely typed, a string of 1 could be the same as 1 itself, right? And a string of 1 could be the same as 1 and could be the same as true, okay? So when we use a strict equal, it will strictly identify the type, which could be string, it could be integer, it could be true, false. Right, so if I were to type, if I was to check if something is strictly a 1, integer of 1, if you pass in a string of 1, it will fail. It will return a false. Right, we'll have some code later on to show you how. So add to is to add to the existing variable, append the value to the existing variable. Subtract from the variable, increase by 1 is plus plus, decrease by 1, and operator, which is to check something and something, or operator something or something. Right, let's get on the code itself. So let's play with some variables. You can try to write this code at the same so get practicing a little bit in your helloworld.php. Dollar sign in underscore variable equals find in variable plus plus echo in variable. What would you get? Right, you get something like 6, right? So when I run this, I'll get 6. Okay, the 6 is very small. But yeah. What I did here was I increased by 1, which is the plus plus operator here. I just used the plus plus operator. You understand the syntax of setting and increasing by 1? Simple. Just remember that these are like your x, y, z in your algebra classes. Just that we are putting a dollar sign in front of it, right? So it could be something like dollar sign x, right? Dollar sign x and dollar sign x, right? So this is exactly like what you've learned in your secondary school classes of basic algebra, which is very basic. Yeah. We are not even doing any problem solving in math yet. Alright, so these are really, really simple. So when what happens when 5 get increased by 1? It becomes 6. Then output 6. Everyone clear? Good. All good. Thumbs up. Anyone? Okay, I only see one thumbs up, so I'm gonna wait a while. Can you all understand? Understand? Okay, so I'm gonna move on. So now we've done some playing with operators, very simple play and all. We wanna do more than just that, right? Right, this is just secondary school work. Let's move on to secondary school 1.1, which is to add 2, right? So when you do this, right, it adds the value given here into the previous value. So you've got 5 here. Imagine this thing is 5 and plus the 3, and then you set it again. So in variable will then become 8. It's adding the 3 here into that 5 and then setting it to 8. Cool? So just now was just increasing by 1 only, which is just plus plus. Now if you want to increase by 2 or 3 or 10 or 100 or 1 trillion, you use this plus equals. Okay? Cool? Okay, so I'm just going to type in the code as well, along with all of you. Plus equals 3, then I get 8. Right? So down here, I get 8. Are you all starting to feel it? Feeling how useful secondary school life would be? Feeling the regret that you didn't pay attention to your teacher in math class? Right, so unfortunately, teacher's days was over. So I hope that you guys have all visited your teachers in secondary school and thank them for teaching you math. Right, so I think I just broke this. Okay, I didn't. Okay, so very simple secondary school 1.1 stuff. Let's move on to 1.2, which is the minus. Right, same as the plus, but now we minus, subtract from, right? So minus equals 3, it'll become 2. Very simple, right? Okay, all of you got it already? Minus equals, which is essentially the same as plus, except you're subtracting. Simple. Right, all you can see from behind, right? All can see? Behind? Can see? Good, okay, great. So this is just the subtraction part. So let's move on to even further. Now we use the if, else, else if, and stuff. So this is where the part where we do logical checking, right? We want to test whether you have a brain that is logical, right? So obviously a computer has a brain and it can think logically, but not all humans can, right? So anyway, we're gonna use what we call comparison. We want to check whether this thing is this thing is this thing is this thing or what, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, so what will be the result of this? Okay, wait, before that, we're gonna run through the code a bit, explaining through what is happening. So simple declaration, variable declaration here. Int underscore variable equals 5. Okay, then we check if integer variable is equal to 5. So is 5 equals to 5? Yes, right. So what do? We echo LL. And that's it. It stops there. Nothing more, nothing less. It just ignores the rest of it. Else if and everything. Everything else gets ignored. Okay? Very simple logical operator here. We'll use the if operator here. okay, equals, is equal, which is a double equal sign. Okay, remember it's a double equal sign, not a single equal. A single equal is a set already, setting a variable, right? Then echo LOL. So when you run this script, it will output on your browser LOL, right? And you might be thinking, what is this else if? What is this else? Right, so if the integer was 6, if here it was 6, it will run through this. Is 6 equals to 5? No, it's not. Let's continue down the road. Is 6 equals to 6? Yes, it is. Then you print out ruffle. Is that how you pronounce it? Ruffle. Alright, so what happens if you change this integer variable to 7? Right. So we'll go through again the logical loop, the logical if else check. Is 7 equals to 5? No, it's not. So we go down to the next else if. Is 7 equals to 6? No, it's not. So it falls to else. Then it'll just print out lmao. Right, so if it's not 5, if it's not 6, it'll just print lmao. Lmao. Right, so take note that these are curly braces, which is something that is similar to your CSS. And remember that everything has to end when you run a function or anything, it has to end with a semicolon. Okay? So let's just run through this script very quickly. So when we run through this, you go here, it'll say law. And when we change from here 5 to 6, and then we refresh, we get waffle. And then we change it to 7, we get lmao. Lmao. I particularly like these phrases, like law, ruffle, lmao, because they sound very weird. Everyone got it? Cool? Okay, that's great. So now that we've gone through some very easy logical checking, let's go on to the next step of playing with operators. Right, so what will happen here? Can anyone tell me what's gonna happen here? What will be the result? Anyone knows? Law, law. Great. Okay, you get a t-shirt. So, yeah, as she said, the result is law. Why is it so? Anyone? Why is it law? Why is it not waffle? The second part here it says, it's checking if it's equals to 5. Why does it just stop here at the log? Right. So, well, there's a very simple reason behind this. Let's relate back to how PHP variables work. Okay, so PHP variables, they are of juggling type. Right. So, what is a true and what is a false? Right. A false is a zero. Right. In binary terms, we got 0 and 1s, right? So a false is a 0. Anything that is not 0 is true, right? So we've got 5, and if it's checking if 5 is true. Is 5 true? Is 5 not 0? 5 is not 0, so it'll print log. So this is this might take some time to digest in. You need to swallow this in if needed. Yeah, so this is the magic of juggling with PHP variables. But here comes a tricky thing, right? So when programmers, they develop their applications like that, what would happen? Right, you get a bunch of spaghetti code. Right, so spaghetti code, right, is essentially codes that looks like a pile of mess. Right, so if you really want to check whether a variable is something or something like that, right, would highly suggest you to use this kind of equal sign so that the next programmer that takes after your work won't call this work a piece of crap. Right. So leave some code that are readable, have codes that are consistent. Yeah, so these are very essential things that you need to know. Okay, so some modulus part. So what would be the result? Anyone knows the result? Okay, is it the amount? No, it's not. Sorry. Okay, so the result is actually ruffle. So again, back to the juggling thing again. When 5 modulus by 5, you get a remainder of 0. 0 is false, right? So it skips the log. Then it goes to the second part. Integer variable modulus 3 is 2. So you get 2, which is not 0, which is true. And then it prints ruffle. Alright, so this is some of the shenanigans here. Alright, so this is how you use modulus. Do you want to take a break first? You all seem very tired. That's 10 minutes break, I guess. 10 minutes break. Okay, great. We'll pause for a 5 minutes break until 2:30. Yeah, 2:30.
Thank you. Thank you.
PHP, it's just a question of like, what am I doing now? What project am I doing? What language
do
I have? Facebook wants dedicated focus experts. I'm a generalist. You told me which people you have. I just did it over the weekend, marketing, events, organize conferences.
Okay, so is everyone back from the break? Everyone recharged from the break. Am I going too fast? Sorry? Which part is it too fast? Okay, is there any particular part that you all don't understand right now? Any parts that were unclear? What are the parts that were unclear? Good. Okay. Okay, sure. You're sure? Better be sure. Okay, so just now we covered a bit on PHP, syntax, variable declaration, operators, plus, minus, plus, equals, plus, plus, modulus, now, void is not now, integer, floats, variable types, juggling, this and that, if, else statements, else statements, curly braces, brackets, and many more, okay? So that was what we covered on previously before we had our 10 minutes break. So let's move on to the loops part. So for any language to be Turing complete, it needs to have this essential function of loops, because the infinite stream of form that you need to read and write on is infinite. So you need to use what we call loops. So with loops, we have essentially achieved almost half Turing completeness, right? So that's what you will see in any programming languages: loops, structural if-else statements, variables type, operators, and many more. So these are the very very common things that you'll find in any programming language, right? Except for maybe Golang. Okay, so loops, we've got for loops, we've got for each loop, we've got while loops, different type of loops available. We'll go through how each loop and use case of each loop itself, and when and why you should use this particular loop. So let's go through the first one, which is a for loop. So in a for loop, you've got a for, open bracket. Okay, so you all have seen the if and else and all of that. They've got this open bracket thing. Do you see this bracket? Right. So in a if, right, we've got that as well. In a for loop, we've got that as well. Do you see a similarity? Right. It kind of look like a function, doesn't it? Kind of. Okay, so we won't really go through what really is a function, but this thing here is what we use to go to apply a for loop. Okay, so it'll check through what is inside this these brackets here. These are okay, so this there's different kind of brackets out there. There's angular brackets, there's braces, which are also curly brackets. And there's also this round brackets which are called parentheses. Okay, you need to know that this is parentheses. So from now on, I'm just gonna say parentheses and you're gonna take it as curly your round brackets. Understood? Okay, so we've got parentheses here and we've got a dollar sign I equals zero. So essentially here we are declaring a variable I is set to zero, and then we've got a semicolon, which is to say that this end the first part of the statement, we're gonna move on to the next part of the statement. I is smaller than 5. Okay, so in your basic mathematics secondary school class, you've got this angular thing, which is to check whether it's lesser than, equal to, lesser than or equal to, more than or equal to, less than, more than. Okay, so this is, so my mathematics teacher teach me a very simple way of identifying whether it's a lesser than or more than operator. So she told me this: the smaller number will eat the bigger number. Okay, so what does it mean? Does this thing looks like a mouth to you? This looks a bit like a mouth, right? So the smaller number here, which is the I, will eat number 5, which is the bigger number. Right, simple, right? That's one of the magic tricks that my mathematics teacher taught me, and I still remember till date. Right, so I is smaller than 5. Then semicolon, and the next statement, I plus plus, which is to increase by 1. Simple? Okay, so what really happens now? Right, so okay, so we set I as 0. Right. Okay, let's just print out this whatever we have wrote here first. Okay? So I set to 5. I feel so lazy now. So before I copy and paste this code, I'm just gonna print out what is I first, okay? So you can see that it printed out 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and that's it. Okay, let me make it more clear. So by the way, these double slashes here, do you see this double front slash? These are what we call comments. Okay, so comments are for documentation and information kind of stuff, right? It's just there to help people, right? So if someone else was to read your code, you have to have some form of documentation to help them read your code, right? So we can put this thing, this comment blocks to help people read. Read what they're trying to do here. So this part here, we've got in equals 5, then it says declare the variable, right? So we echo what is I, and then we get 0 1 2 3 4. So what happened was that we declared I as 0, and then we print out what is I, which is 0. So you print out echo 0, and then one is done printing out 0, it will go to the next part, which is to check is 0 smaller than 5. Yes, it is. So let's increase 0 by 1 to become one. Then we bring out the echo quote again. We echo out the quote again, then we get one. Right. Then we no wait. I plus plus one. Okay, let me check two, then three, no. Zero, four. Okay, so when after it increases already, right, so it becomes one, then it checks whether one is smaller than five. Is one smaller than five? Yes, it's smaller than five, so we print out one. Okay, then we increase one by one, so we get two. Then we go through again, two, is it smaller than five? Yes, we print out, then we increase. Three, is it smaller than five? Yes, it is. Then we print out, then we increase. Is four smaller than five? Yes, it is. Then we print out, then we increase by one. Is five smaller than five? No, we get out. So that's the end of it. So once it reaches five, which is not smaller than five, we end the for loop, right? So as long as the condition there is true, then it will do whatever it needs to do. So you've got the declaration here, which is I equals to zero, and you've got the condition here, and you've got what? Okay, so let's look directly into the documentation itself. So there's this website called php.net, which is the official documentation site for PHP. Alright, so okay, so for okay, so there's three expressions here. Oh, this is messy. Okay, so we've got three expressions here. Expression 1, expression 2, expression 3. Okay, so you can see that this is only executed once. Alright, so expression 1 is executed once, which is kind of like what C does. PHP is very similar to the C syntax, very similar. Then expression 2 is your conditional check. It must evaluate to true or for the for loop to continue on. Then you have the expression 3, which is executed or evaluated at the end of each successful loop, right? Got it? And if you've got any other question about the language or the functions or whatsoever, you can always look up on the PHP documentation site and take a look at it. Okay? So now we've done with the for loop. But we can do more than just that, right? We can try to do this, and we get, if my mathematics is not wrong, it should output 15. So for this part, right, it's just I equals 0, same thing. If I is smaller than 5, then you do in class equals I, Then after that, it evaluates I++. So, let's try to type some code. Right. Yes, my math is correct. Yay. So we got 15. So we've been playing around with loops, for loop with simple integers and very simple integers. But we can do more than that. We can manipulate strings. We can manipulate loops. We can do calculations. We can do lots of stuff just by using simple mathematics, right? So, but before that, we're gonna try the while loop. So while is a more simple expression, which checks whether something is true, right? So let me show you something real quick. So don't try and run this, yeah. Don't run this. Trust me. Anyway, so when you run this, you go into an infinite loop, and it will drain all your server resources, and eventually your server will go into a deadlock, right? So a while loop is essentially it only evaluates one expression, one condition, and check whether the condition is true or not. It evaluates the expression and check whether it outputs to true. So if it's true, then you'll do it, right? So here we've got while true echo log. So it'll infinitely output LOL on your browser, right? It's an infinite loop. So this is, okay, I'm going to show you some bad programming practices first, and you're going to tell me why are they bad, right? Justin, huh? When you see a loop, is it a break?
Yeah.
It's a break, right? Mm. Okay, let's check it.
Infinite?
If I go into infinite loop, how? Okay, so I hope I don't go into infinite loop. Okay, I didn't. Okay, good. So, this is very bad programming practice. Can anyone tell me why? It's really, really bad programming, but it works, right? But doesn't mean it works, you should do it, right? We've got different things in life that we can do, but we shouldn't. Like, we could possibly run around naked everywhere. You could, but you should, right? So this is one of those things that you could, but you shouldn't. Okay, so this is really, really, really bad programming practice. sometimes you will see this in legacy code or really crappy code. Don't be surprised. Even some big companies out there, they've got codes like that, right? Don't be surprised. So if oh, okay. So I won't mention any big company names.
I'm gonna refute you. A while loop is very important in game programming and it's widely used across all game programming for the fundamentals of
But you can't do this.
It is a while loop, including also rendering your message queue and everything is all a while loop.
Yes, yes.
And it's while loop true. It's an infinite loop. And that's the basics of Windows programming also. And a lot of the windowing programming. So it's not bad practice.
Mm-hmm.
It's only used in certain situations. Okay?
Yes. Okay, so like what Justin corrected earlier on is only should be this is very bad practice in web programming languages, right? So so if you ever do like in most contexts, right, you shouldn't be doing this, right? In most basic contexts, you shouldn't be running this while true break kind of stuff. Right, what we should be trying to do is we should be trying to do this instead. Something like that. Something, right? But not exactly there yet. Okay. So this is the same thing. This is exactly the same thing, but it's structured in a better way, right? It checks for the conditional here. It checks for the condition here, and then it evaluates whether it's true or not accordingly, right? But this is still not exactly what we want to do, right? We want to be more specific as possible and try to figure out what we are actually trying to achieve here. Right, so if we want to print LOL 5 times, we could use a for loop, right? We could use a while loop, right? But for everything we do, it should be used for different contexts. So a while loop can be used to evaluate more complex expressions, right? So what do I mean by that, right? So let me show you very quickly. So right here, in a while loop, I've added in this AND operator to further increase the complexity when needed. Right. So in certain scenarios such as this, right, it will be more appropriate to use while loops instead of just a single for loop, because for loop would only evaluate us integers and things like that, right? So that's for the. So we've covered two loops. There's also a for each loop that we would. That is not really that used for now. In the later parts, we'll be using more of it. Okay, so. You know, we've done variables, we've done this kind of printing of numbers and all of that. Is this really useful enough yet to do a fantastic Alibaba shop? Not quite yet, right? So we've done certain stuff, we've evaluated certain things and all, but it's not there yet, right? So, actually, let's go through more of the array side, which would be more useful in when we come to our shop, right? Because we want to contain certain data and operate out and give it to the user and all of that, right? We just go through some arrays first, basic arrays, and then we'll go through sessions. Okay, so arrays first, then followed by sessions. Thank you. Let's see. So there's multiple ways of actually being able to declare variables, but the try to go with the first one. Stick to consistent code. So even if you, let's say you choose the second one, you can use it, of course, no issues. But always make sure you are consistent. So don't halfway through the code you decided, oh hey, I'm gonna use array parentheses, or say, oh, halfway through I'm gonna say, oh, I'm gonna use square brackets to declare variables. When you use square brackets, use it throughout your entire code. Don't change it halfway or so. Be consistent and choose one. Okay, don't choose both halfway. Okay, and also make sure in PHP we've got PSR, which are PHP standard recommendations, states that we should be using four spaces instead of tabs. Okay, so remember to use four spaces. Here you can click onto four here, and then you click onto four space. So for PHP files, the standard recommendation set by the standards is to use four spaces. Okay, whereas for HTML and JavaScript, there's no particular standard governing to use how many spaces or to use tabs or not. So for PHP, use four spaces. Okay, good. So now I'm gonna keep to using the first one, which is just a square bracket there for simplicity's sake, and I'm gonna evaluate some pretty neat variables. So you gentlemen over there, what fruit do you eat?
Watermelon.
Okay, watermelon. The lady over there. Yes, you. What fruit do you eat?
Dew.
Dew. What? Dew? What?
No, I'm just kidding.
Honeydew, okay. Just kidding. Okay. The fine gentleman sitting at the front row there. Yes, you. Why are you looking away? So what fruit do you eat?
Mango.
Okay, so we've got watermelon, we've got just kidding, we got mango. Three types of fruit found in Singapore, I think, but you can't grow them. So there are an array of strings here, you can see. Here, right. So what will happen if I just echo it out? What will happen, right? You see? It just say array. You might be running, what? What the heck is this, right? So in order to evaluate what is inside these variables even, right? We got things such as print r or var dump. So in this case, let's use var dump. It's a function. So a function has a parenthesis. Let me type out for you to see. So var dump is one of the functions that we can use in PHP to vomit out the values we have. Okay, for more complex debugging and more, we can use things like xdebug, but we wouldn't be covering xdebug in this session alone. We'll be just using simple tools to output out things that we need to know. Right. So when we var dump array of strings, we get this array. A collection of array tree, starting from 0 is string, 10 characters, watermelon, number 1, by the way, in PHP, numbers start from 0, right? The index numbers start from 0. So it's 0, 1, 2, 3, onwards, so on and so forth. Alright, so we've got 0, which is the first one, 1, which is the second one, 2, which is the third one. So it says here it's a string. and it's a string type with 12 characters. Just kidding. String type, 5 characters, mango. Right, and it's closed with a curly bracket again. So this is what happens when you var dump it. Okay? So, but what if I don't want to var dump that? That looks kind of ugly, isn't it? I want to echo that. How do I do it? Well, we've got this thing called for each loop, which I'm going to introduce it to you now. You would have noticed that sometimes where some functions like echo, they don't need parentheses, alright, but echo is still a function. Alright, so what are functions, right? So functions are basically the predefined PHP functions that kind of like a collection of operation. So within this function, right, you've got things that will execute and then it outputs something. Right, it will return something. So when we echo, right, it will return an output into a browser itself. So when we do this, for each array of strings as fruit, right, so it will go into each for each, because every single one, right. So it will go inside each item in the array. And it prints out. So for the first one, right, we go inside the first one, it's a watermelon. So fruit, the first fruit is watermelon. Then it prints out. Then it goes to the second one. Just kidding. And as fruit, then echo, just kidding. Just kidding. Okay, then the third one, we put mango. Right, then it goes through, it goes to the third one, then mango is our fruit, and echo, mango. So let's see what happens now. Watermelon, just kidding, mango. Right. So this is what happened when you print that out. But it still looks like crap. So how will you make it onto the print out a new line, right? Well, what is this? Can anyone tell me what is this? This is a browser, right? A browser can do this magical thing called rendering HTML, right? So in browsers, we could essentially print out paragraphs. We could print out break lines and many more, right? So I'm gonna do something first. I'm gonna print out a paragraph element. And then we'll do some cleanup. So now, if you look at the code, we've got three different paragraphs. What did I do? So I printed out P and then I printed out P again, closing the tag. Let's look inspect in the element itself. Do you see this? P, watermelon, close P, P, just kidding, close P, P, mango, close P. Easy, right? So it's just printing out P. Really, it's just that. So, but now we've got three lines of echoes. Can we clean it up? Right. Can we make it shorter? Well, we can. And we should. And we shall. Right, so let's clean up our code a little bit and make it look nicer. So how do we join these strings together? We could use a variable, right? And then we use a plus equals and then add it inside. So plus equals doesn't apply only just to integers. It could apply to strings as well, right? But we don't want to do that. That's extra work, extra hassle that we don't even need to do that. We just need to concatenate this string together. So how do we concatenate things together? So what is concatenation even, right? So concatenation is like gluing things together, right? You apply glue and then you stick it together, right? So in PHP, we can join strings together using a dot. And that is how you do it. A dot. And a dot. Another dot. Two dots. So it's gluing these things together. So right, you might be asking, hey, why can't we put it inside a string? Right, why can't we just do this? Would this work? Anyone knows? Does this work? Well, it does. Let me show you. Wow. What are these? Okay, so it's loading a bit slowly. It's not even loading. Yeah, so you've got your text printed out already. Really? This is horrifying. Okay, you know what? So yes, it does work, right? It will work as expected. Okay, this thing has loaded already, so I'm... Are you kidding me? So, yeah, it does work. Okay? It works, nevertheless. Okay, so, but then, what if I change this double quote into a single quote? When I change it to a single quote, what will happen to the variable, right? What is this? What are those? So, essentially, PHP has a weird way of, not really weird, but it's unique way of rendering strings and things. Right, so when it's given a single quote, it will not do whatever, it will not render the variable, okay? But if you put a double quote, it would, right? So, for general practice, it's good, it would kind of be good to, it's really a personal preference, to use concatenation instead, right? So it's pretty clear in some sense to know whether a string, if something is a variable, right? we could contact. So let's be a bit consistent, and then use this, right? So I'm a bit ironic right now because I'm using single quote here, and then I'm using double quotes here. So let me keep it to. Let's keep everything to single quote now. Okay, so this would work, right? See, now it worked. So this is how PHP works. And remember the difference between a single quote and a double quote. Both can be strings, but variables would not be rendered in a single quote, right? And you've got other things such as new line, end of line, and all many things that would not be rendered in standard single quote. Okay. So just keep this in mind, and now that we have played with for each loop, we want to do more than just that, right? So now let's do a login form, right? This is the moment we've been all waiting for. Finally, a login form, right? So now I'm getting breathless. Create a file named login.php. Right, then delete this. We can sort of delete this hello world for now. And then create a login.index.html. login.html. Okay, so why is this guy doing this? What, login.php and a login.html? What is this? What are those? So in the standard login.html, don't worry, I'm just gonna copy this and then modify it. Alright, so now let me basically introduce to you a new HTML form. Don't worry about the code and all. I'll post it on the Google Doc. I'll copy and paste the code in the Google Doc later. So introducing to you a brand new element named form. And what is a form? Right. Well, a form is something that you fill up with, right? You input data, and then you send it off to where? To somewhere, right? It could be anywhere. It could be a PHP file, it could be a Ruby file, it could be a Python file, it could be anywhere, right? So you send this particular form with whatever input results you have within this form itself. So let's declare some stuff within the form. So during a login process, what would you need? A username, probably a username, right? So And input is also a self-closing tag. You don't need to, yeah. So another attribute you will see here is called name. So when you send a data over to the server, how would you know what is this? Right, it needs to have a key. You have the value, but what's the key? Right, there's always a key and a value to know what is this even. So when we put name equals username, we know that the key is the username. And the value would be whatever the user type in. Okay? So I'm just gonna type in a password field and a submit button. So when I go to the login page, right, I'll see this thing, a username and a password field. Right, so maybe my username could be Wu Huiren. That was my password. Maybe password. Right, something like that. Right, but isn't it a bit odd? Does it look odd to you? My password is just being blatantly flashed out like that. Right, so let's look at how Facebook designed its site. Right, because we can't create, in order to create the next Facebook, we need to copy what Facebook does. Right, so if we take a look here, we can type in our email, right? So maybe something like that. But then when we type in our password, what are those? Those are censored stuff, right? You can't see it, right? You can't see what I type. So there must be something wrong with what I've done just now, right? Because my password can be seen. It's a bit odd, right? So let's go back to our code here and see what might be wrong. So in our form here, we've got three input: text, submit, and then login, username, password, right? So, well, this problem has been solved in the early days of the 90s. Right, so anyway, the type should be changed to password. So when the type is set to password, we'll see something magical happen. Right, when I type in my password, you can't see anything. Right, so this is a type. Input type attribute. There are different kinds. There can be number, there can be text, there can be password, there can be email even. Right, so there's even email as an input type. Something like that. Right, and there's also a submit type. Right, so but when is the form going to be submitted to, right? The form will be submitted to the same particular page, which is index.html. But there's nothing that can process index.html. It's just a web server. There's no pre-processing done by PHP, right? So we need to send it off to the PHP file. How can we achieve that? Well, introducing to you a new attribute type, attribute named action, right? Yeah, action. So let's take a look at how Facebook does its site, right? So it has the standard input type, table, form, and it has the action as well, right? So it's pointing to this, the Facebook site is pointing towards this file named login.php. So We're going to do the same as well. We're going to point it to login.php, which is our blank empty file here. Right. But before we move on, we're going to beautify it a little bit. So I'm going to add some classes in to make it look nicer, at least a little bit. So that looks slightly better, I guess. And we're gonna tell the user what this is. This is a username, right? So we need a user to know it's a username. So we could put a text in front and say username, right? We could do this, right? And the person will know, oh, this is a username, this is a password. And we could do that. But, okay, so this is a good thing to do as well. But maybe we want to make it even better. Right. So now, you know that this is a password field and this is a username field. Quite simple, isn't it? So that was the placeholder tag. Placeholder attribute that you can use within inputs as well. So let's for now, we're gonna go here, and then we're gonna add this page in. So this is a login.html. So I've updated with this login.html file, which includes the form that you can use to log in. Alright. So let's do something very simple. Okay, so just now earlier on I mentioned that there's like this gap. If you vaguely recall back, when we retrieve a file, there's a get and there's a file name, there's all of this and all of that, right? So there's this thing called get. So by default, requests are get, right? But for login, we want to send a post request, right? There's reason why we want to send a post request instead of get request. So in the HTTP specification itself, there's different type of requests you can send to a server. There's get, there's post, there's put, there's delete, there's put. Wait, did I mention it twice? Yeah, so there's really different type of HTTP requests you can send, right? So by default, it's a get request. Okay, so when I visit facebook.com, it's a get request, and that's it, right? So a get request is to get a resource from the server itself. Right? It could be any resource. It could be a HTML resource, it could be a JSON resource, it could be XML resource. But the most important thing is it can be cached. Right? So it can be cached on your browser side. And other than that, if you submit a form in a GET request format, it will appear in your browser browser URL as a query string. So let me show you what happens, right? When I try to log in. So when I put in and I type in my password. You can't see it, right? You can't see what I type. But what if I press the login button? It sends me to login.php, which is what the action was pointing to. And then if you look here, it says username equals something and password equals very secret password. Oh shit, my password just got revealed in the browser. So this is what happens when you use a GET request instead of a POST request. So for generally things like a login or registration, we want to do a POST request instead of GET request, or else we'll end up with this thing on top here with my secret password down there, right? So let's change the form to make it a POST request. Okay, so down here, let's modify this together. We go down the form action equals login.php. We set the method equals POST. Actually, just POST, right? So now let's go back here and we type in the same thing. Refresh the browser. Type in the same thing. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. All right. So it can be seen on top here, right? Very clearly. Okay, but you can see down here, the method has been set to POST. Right, can you see? Request method POST. And then, under parents, we can still see that the form data being sent is Wu Huiren and the password is LL. It's a POST request now. It doesn't appear up on this here, but you know that this parameters has been sent over to the PHP server. Simple, right? All right, everyone got it so far? Everyone understand the difference between a GET and a POST? GET POST. Very simple concept. Okay, cool. Okay, so now we visibly literally saw the difference between a GET and a POST. Okay, and we understood the use case of a GET and a POST. Let's try to apply the use case now. Okay, so I'm going to update the code on Google Docs first. Okay, so I updated the Google Docs. So now for PHP, we wanna know what are parameters being sent over to the server, right? So how do we know if it's what data it is, right? Well, in PHP, we have got global variables, right? So there's this global variable called POST, which is basically an array of POST parameters being sent over to the server, right? So let's see what happens, right? We've got this POST variable. It's a global variable. Okay, so in PHP, there are some reserved variables that you should not go and touch. And one of them is pose. Don't try to modify pose. Right, you could, but again, it's not something that you should, right? So right now when I log in, I bar down the result out. It's an array. You saw it was an array. Of course it was. Of course it is. Right? And then within username, you've got a string of 9 characters. Where? Password, string of 3 characters, LOL. Right, so using the same concept that we've learned earlier on of debugging, using var dump and many more, we've achieved a new revelation of doing things. Right, so within post itself, it's an array. Now that we know that the global variable of post is an array of the parameters that was sent over, let's verify data, shall we? So this is how we pick out that particular array value within that array, right? So do you remember when your, okay, let's keep it consistent, right? So do you remember when we use square brackets and all for arrays? Well, this is how it looks similar to how declaring and getting a value from a particular array. So if you want to go inside that particular array, we could use a for each. But in this scenario, we just want to pick out certain elements, certain things, certain parameters within this post values, right? So we only specifically want to get the username and the password. So where is this username from? Right, so look back at the index. Look back at the login.html, the name. It's the parameter name. And we've got a parameter name for the password as well, which is password. Okay, so username, password are the parameter names. Okay, it's not just name like that, it's a key value. Okay? So now we want to retrieve the post the variable within this array, which we can get it through using open square bracket, single quote, username, single quote, close square bracket. Okay, simple, right? This is how you access the variable within the array. Cool? Understandable? Okay, if you ever don't understand anything within PHP itself, experiment and var dump the results, and you know what is the thing even, right? Okay, so now we want to check whether the user is an admin or member or whatsoever, right? So let's create an array of users. Right. So, just now we've done a... Oh yeah, I'm gonna put it up on doc first. Hold on. So now it'll tell me that I'm logged in as Wu Huiren. Right, simple, right? So we've made use of for each loop which was taught just now. So you see that we've got an array within an array, right? So how does that even work, right? So this is what we call a multi-dimensional array. So an array within an array. Cool, right? So essentially, what we can do is that we can have even more users. Right, so... The guy wearing the green jacket over there. Yes, you. Yes, what's your name?
Fabian.
Sorry?
Fabian.
Fabian. Okay, Fabian. What password do you use?
Lamao.
Why didn't you give me your real password? Alright, so... Okay, so Fabian has kindly surrendered his password to me. And now I can log into his emails and Facebook accounts. Anyway, so we've got an array here. And inside this array, we've got two arrays. Do you see it? We've got one array, one gigantic array that encapsulates two arrays. Understood? Okay? No? Yes? No? Okay, so essentially, we've previously declared a new array here, right? So, we can actually put in, there's different type of variables that we can put in, right? We can put in strings, we could put in integers, we can put in another array, right? So we can have an array inside an array inside an array, it goes on and on, right? So here, we've got one array that contains two arrays, and inside each of these arrays that are contained within this gigantic array has a username and has a password. Okay, so this username here is the key, and this is the value, key, value. Key, value. And if let's say you don't define a key, which was what I did here, I didn't define a key for this variable, for this array here. There wasn't any array, there wasn't any key defined for this. It would just automatically define it as zero. The key would still be existent, which would be zero. So although I didn't define a key, there's still a key, no matter what. Right. So down here, we went through a for loop, for each loop. So for each users we have, it will be as a user, right? So we got two users down here, right? Which is two arrays, right? Each user is represented with one array, right? This is the first user. This entire part here is the first user. The second part here is the second user, which is Fabian. Right. Okay. So, what this means is that, and so what this will do is that it'll check if the username is the same as the username inputted in this array here. Right. And then it'll check if the password that is in the form is the same as the password given here in this array. Right, it's just essentially a is equal check. Right? Very simple. And if it's true, we say that we print out log in as the username. And then we break. Break, which is to get out of the loop. Because once we're already logged in, we don't really need to go through other iterations, right? We've already got the result we wanted. So what's the point of continuing the loop? It will just waste more resources, right? So we just stop the loop, since we've already got our job done. Right, so we break the loop and we get out of the loop, and everything is set. Okay, it's a pretty easy concept here. So as you can see here, the password are stored in plain text format, right? And the password here is still plain text as well. might be a security issue down here, isn't it? And let's look at another issue that we would have, right? Let me show you a particular issue that we've achieved down here. Okay, so I've in particular username here and a username here. Well, printing out the username that was given to us, right? So what we could potentially do is do this, right? We can say this ll no, we can't. Let's do a simple something. Hold on. So we got a true or false a boolean here, which is initialized as a false. And then when the user is logged in, it'll be changed to a true. Simple, right? And then after the loop, right, we'll do this. Exclamation mark. Okay, so exclamation mark is the inverse operation. Right, so if the value is true, it'll become false. If the value is false, it'll become true. So right here, if the user is logged in, it won't do anything in here. Right, is this clear? Only users not logged in will do this. The exclamation mark is the inverse of the variable. Right, so yeah, understood. So when the user is logged in is set to true. It's set to true. Right. Then here it checks if false equals to true. False does not equals to true. False is not true. False is not true. So what do? False is not true, right? So we can't go in anymore. We don't go in here. We just skip. Right? Okay, good. Alright, so only users who failed to log in will have this. something like that, right? Okay, so let's take a look. Don't worry about the code yet. I'll just show you all quickly. So I type a wrong password. I type a wrong password here. Then you tell me username Wuheren is incorrect, right? Because that was a wrong password. Okay, so let's do something funny here. Let's actually put in some HTML elements into it. And then we give a wrong password again. And you see that, crap. Now your username has been injected with HTML, right? So one general rule of thumb is that you don't want to trust any input that your user give, right? So any input that is sent to the server should be sanitized, should be checked, and so on and so forth, right? Because right now I can send some HTML over and possibly do something that could even do more damage, right? This is just a very simple scenario of the importance of sanitizing user input, right? So, how do we sanitize this input that was given to us, right? We use what we call HTML entities. Right, so let's take a look here. Is it HTML entities? Okay, so it is. So let's refresh this page. This is slow. Okay, so what it will do is it will clean up stuff, right? So this is just one of the basics of sanitizing your user input and all. So we're gonna upload. Are you kidding me? Anyway, you see this now? No, it does this. Okay, so I'm gonna upload this code right now to this thing here. So yeah, that's how it will work. This is a very simple, sort of like a login with no session yet. But we've managed to have some sort of basic login, right? So that's it for today's workshop, I guess. Everyone understood everything so far? Good. Maybe, yes, no. Okay, feel free to stay behind if you have any questions. We'll be still around and ask us any questions if you need anything. Yeah. And of course the code will be up on Google Docs as well. The video will be uploaded onto engineers.sg for people to recap whatever they need or for folks that were not able to make it for today's lesson, today's workshop. And yeah, thank you all of you for coming down, and especially all our volunteers, Ivan, Chester, Justin, and all our volunteers who helped out. Alright, okay. Awkward silence. Okay, hope to see you next week. Thank you.